Richard, thank you so much for the introduction and for the invitation to share my thoughts with you. And when Richard invited me to give the talk, he specifically asked that I will do Beauty and the Beast because, you know, when we go out and lecture, we normally lecture about the great parts of LIRADS, but he also wanted to discuss a little bit about the challenges that are yet not solved. So this is my disclosure. So what we'll do in the next 25 minutes or so, we will overview CT-MR diagnostic algorithm very briefly. We will talk about benefits of LIRADS, which is our beauty piece, and then a few challenges of LIRADS, which is our the beast piece. And since we only have 25 minutes, and since the approach of this webinar is kind of very practical one, I will focus on these benefits and challenges which are currently presented in clinical practice, and I will not discuss the esoteric scientific things of which there are many as well. So let's start with overview and CT-MR diagnostic algorithm. We have 8 diagnostic categories which are assigned in 4 steps. Step 1 is to apply the decision tree and the table. So we go stepwise from top to bottom, considering all of these categories. And once we dismiss all of these categories, we will proceed to assigning LR3, 4, or 5 category based on the diagnostic table. And since diagnostic table is kind of the highlight of LIRADS, I'm going to go through an example of how we're going to apply it. And again, remember that we apply the table only once we consider and dismiss all the categories listed in the decision tree. So here's an example, 42-year-old woman with cirrhosis. We have an 18 millimeter observation enhancing similarly to Luvan arterial phase, has a washout, T2 hyperintensity and diffusion restriction. This is neither benign or doesn't have any targetoid features to assign LRM category. So we're going to proceed with the table. First thing we're going to look is whether or not there's arterial phase hyperenhancement. And here, since it doesn't hyperenhance, there's no arterial phase hyperenhancement. So we're going to select part of the table labeled no AFI. The next step is to look at the observation size. In this case, it's 18 millimeters. So we're going to select the column labeled less than 20 millimeters. The final step is to count additional major features. In this case, we have non-peripheral washout. We don't have capsule or threshold growth, which means we're going to select the row labeled 1. An intersection of the row and the column gives us a cell with appropriate category, which is LR3. So that's our step 1. Step 2 is to apply answer features. The step is encouraged, but is listed as optional. So in this case, we have 2 answer features of malignancy, which are mild T2 hyperintensity and restricted diffusion. Even though we have more than 1 answer feature, we can only increase the category by 1. So in this case, we will go from 3 to a 4, with a final category in this case would be assigned LR4. Now, in this case, I would have been happy to report this in LR4, but sometimes we are not sure, even once we go through steps 1 and 2, we're not sure what the final category is. We are deciding between 2 categories. If that is the case, we can apply tie-breaking rules to come up with a final answer. And the final step is very quick. It's a final check just to make sure that the category we're selecting actually makes sense. So this is the algorithm approach in a nutshell. So now, again, we're going to focus on good things and bad things as they apply to use of this algorithm in everyday practice. So we'll start with the beauty piece. The most important thing that I can share with you is that the use of this algorithm is based on, at this point, substantial scientific evidence. So we have several meta-analyses. They all demonstrate similar findings. I'm showing you here the data based specifically on the latest version of CT-MR LIRADS, version 2018. And you can see this is meta-analysis based on over 1,000 lesions. validating each category and providing us with the idea of percentages and proportions of HCC and malignancy that are observed per each LIRS category. Notice as we go from LR1 to LR5, there's linear progression of the probability of malignancy in HCC. And notice that virtually all malignant lesions within these categories are going to be HCC. In LRM, notice that almost all LRM observations are going to be malignant, and about a third are going to be HCCs. Another advantage of use of LIRADs in clinical practice is it potentially can improve performance of users which have less experience with liver imaging. And the data I'm going to show you is based on conscious enhanced ultrasound, but this can be extrapolated to CTMR in a similar manner. So for this study, the junior attendings were asked to assess liver lesions based on COS, and they were asked to determine whether or not the lesion is benign versus malignant using conventional criteria that they were taught in residency, what they use in clinical practice. Then the attendings were taught COS LIRADs and had to reinterpret the lesions. And then the senior, more experienced COS attendings had to assess benign versus malignant liver lesions using their established conventional criteria that they used in clinical practice. And then the performance of two groups were compared. So when we compared the sensitivity using conventional criteria, it's not surprising that the senior radiologists performed better as compared to their junior colleagues. But once the junior colleagues applied COS LIRADs, the sensitivity of their performance was pretty much the same as sensitivity of senior colleagues. Similarly, for specificity using conventional criteria, the senior radiologist outperformed the junior colleagues. But then when the junior colleagues use the LIRADs criteria, you can see that the specificity became equal, if not a little bit better, than the conventional criteria senior. Finally, conventional criteria using comparing positive predictive value of conventional criteria, again, not surprisingly, senior attendings outperformed their junior colleagues, and that that was eliminated once the junior colleagues applied LIRADs, COS LIRADs criteria. So there's at least some evidence that using LIRADs in clinical practice helps the junior, more junior or less experienced users to achieve similar performance to those who have much greater experience in liver imaging. Another thing is that LIRADs offers it. We provide granular categories for the entire spectrum of observations. And what do I mean by that? So if you know that there are multiple imaging-based surveillance and diagnostic systems across the world, and most of them, if not all of them, have a very similar approach to diagnosis of liver lesions. A patient with cirrhosis has a liver lesion, and we diagnose it either benign, assuming that a radiologist has pre-existing knowledge of what benign observations in liver look like, or this observation will meet whatever the set criteria for definite HCC provided by a given system. And everything else is left as an indeterminate lesion, really without any specification as to how to approach these. But these indeterminate lesions comprise quite a variety of observations. Here are three cases with indeterminate liver lesions. Neither of these lesions is definitely benign, and neither of them meet criteria for HCC based on any diagnostic systems. And what do you do with them? Do you follow them? Do you biopsy? Do you just treat them? And notice that these are very different in terms of their sizes, in terms of their imaging features. So probably applying the same approach to these lesions is not appropriate. So who decides how we're going to treat these lesions? And again, these indeterminate category will include quite a wide spectrum of lesions, including benign, premalignant, and malignant entities. And we don't know if biopsy everything approach is practical or cost-effective or improved outcome. And sometimes it may not even be possible because subcentimeter lesions may not be targetable. We really don't have any data to support that biopsy all approach is correct. So then there has to be some gradation as to what to do with these lesions. And without really a diagnostic schema as to how to approach them, the decision of what to do with them is going to be very variable and dependent upon who read the case and what the institutional practices are. What does LIRS offer? Instead of having this bucket of indeterminate lesions, we provide granular categories. And each of these categories, as I showed you before, provides an idea of what the probability of HCC and malignancy for this given lesion is. And then we can use these categories to guide management so that the approach to these indeterminate lesions becomes much more standardized and reproducible across different institutions, as well as their approach to their treatment. So for example, the first case I showed you meets criteria for LIRS 3, so this one is safe to follow. The second case I showed you meets criteria for LIRS 4, so these lesions should be either followed, biopsy, or treated. In this case, this was resected and HCC. And the final is LRM, and this was intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. A huge piece of what LIRS offers is consistent and clear communication. This is a copy and paste of a report which was used at Montefiore, where I was before, before the LIRS was implemented. And I just want to see, this is the impression, suspicious for a possible small HCC. So imagine if you are a clinician and you receive a report that says patient has a lesion which is suspicious for a possible small HCC. What are you supposed to do with such a lesion? Do you biopsy? Do you treat? Do you follow up? How do you approach such a situation? So there was a study that kind of looked at how well the clinicians can infer information from our reports. What they did is they extracted all the clinical reports describing lesions in patients at risk for HCC. And you can just marvel at the variety of terminology that is used within one group. So this is one group of radiologists in the same working together. Look how many ways you can describe these lesions. So these reports were then shown to clinicians and says, and they were asked to infer likelihood of HCC in the provided lesion based on description. And then another radiologist re-reviewed the images and assigned LIRS categories to infer the actual probability based on LIRS. And then these were compared. So the clinical report, the most common phrase was consistent with HCC. And you can see that based on images, the consistent with HCC could mean LR3 or LRTIV, although most commonly it would mean LR5. So you can imagine that LR3 and LRTIV are very different lesions with very different behavior and very different management requirement. But if the clinicians gets consistent with HCC, they really don't know what exactly is meant by this consistent with HCC. And everything else is even worse. So there's not a single phrase that is used consistently to mean the same thing and to provide the same idea to the clinician. When clinicians reviewed the reports, they equally poorly either overestimated or underestimated the likelihood of malignancy, as you can see in a large proportion of patients. So this is, again, back to the original report I showed you, the suspicious for possible small HCC. This is what the images look like for this case. And had the patient came in a year later and we used our LIRS template, this is what the report would have looked like. And this would have been reported as 1.4 centimeter LR5 definite HCC. In this case, the clinician would know what LR5 means. They would know how LR5 should be treated. And so there's no confusion, HCC can confirm, and they can proceed with treatment. The final kind of pieces of clinical advantages of use of LIRS is that it has been adopted by ASLD and UNOS. So ASLD has adopted LIRETS since 2018. This was the guidance paper that came out. Notice this is a table that the paper provides and lists the LIRETS 5 criteria. And then notice that this is listed as ASLD surveillance and diagnostic algorithm. And notice that it uses both ultrasound and CTMR categories from LIRETS. More recently, last year, the quality measure metrics was released, and this is a paper that identifies metrics or criteria which can be used by healthcare providers and systems to measure and improve quality of HCC care. So these quality metrics parameters are explaining how we should a standard of care of patients. And notice this is a table listing final set quality of measures of HCC care. And notice that three of them are listing LIRETS. So LIRETS should be used for interpretation, and then LIRETS 3 and 4 lesions should be managed as per the LIRETS and ASLD management criteria. Now, this slide is from last year, and so ASLD and LIRETS has been unified since 2018, which is a big deal. And our goal was to unify everything within the United States, and we would just have one system, because if you are working at a transplant center, there's some resistance to using LIRETS because OPTN has slightly different criteria. Well, the good news is as of this year, as of the end of this year, we have achieved our goal, in large thanks to Liz Hecht and Katie Fowler, who led this incredible effort. This is a paper that's been accepted in liver transplantation, outlining the fact that the OPTN criteria are now fully aligned with LIRETS, meaning that OPTN class 5A is now completely identical to LIRETS 5. And you can safely use LIRETS in this setting. All right, so these are all great things. So now let's take a few minutes and discuss potential gaps or challenges that you may encounter with the LIRETS. Well, first thing, it is complex, right? It is not a very, one to three system. It does have, some learning curve, and a lot of things you need to know to apply it, right? Again, we have four steps to arrive at the category. Step one is kind of long. We have eight categories. We use five major features to assign the LR three, four, and five categories. We have five targeted LRM features. In addition, we have non-targeted LRM features. We have ANSI features, 21 of them. There are a bunch of rules that you have to follow to make sure that everything is done correctly. So you can imagine this can be quite overwhelming and scary for somebody who's just beginning to learn the system. And the issue is that, yes, LIRETS is not very simple, it is somewhat complex, but imaging of patients with cirrhosis is complex. We want to detect an HCC, but there are many, many other things that can happen in cirrhotic liver, and we have to be able not only detect the HCC, but discern it away from other true lesions, pseudolesions, malignant lesions, premalignant lesions, and benign non-hepatocellular lesions. So an HCC in and of itself as a tumor is a complex entity. We kind of think of it as a single thing, but in reality, not all HCCs are created the same. There are a variety of histological subtypes. There are molecular subgroups. There are differences in genetic alterations and immunohistochemical expressions. There are various oncogenic pathways that can be activated in these tumors. So HCC is a very heterogeneous group of tumors. And as a result, these tumors will not have identical appearance. So as a result, only half to maybe three quarters of path-proven HCCs will meet criteria for LIRETS 5. Some will fall into LIRETS 4 category, a small minority will actually fall into LR3 category, and up to a quarter will fall into LRM category. Now, we don't have time to discuss it, but the appearance of HCC on imaging, what category it falls into, it actually has quite a bit of prognostic information, where Lyrids M HCCs typically are more aggressive with poor outcomes than HCCs that fall into LR5 or LR4 categories. So as Einstein said, everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. There are a few things that we can do to simplify the algorithm just a little bit, and we're working on obtaining evidence to do that. But in general, you know, the Lyrids algorithm is complex because imaging of patients in cirrhosis is complex, and because HCC in and of itself is a complex mass. A more important clinical kind of conundrum that we face currently is heterogeneity of LR3 and LR4 observations. So if we look again at our meta-analytic probabilities, about 30% of LR3 observations are going to be HCC, and about 65% of LR4 observations are going to be HCC. And again, as I mentioned previously, there are a variety of different malignant, premalignant, and benign lesions that we can see in the cirrhotic liver. And if we look at the distribution of these entities throughout our categories, that's approximately what we'll see. And notice these are the HCC kind of bracket. So even though some HCCs will fall into LR3 category, a bunch of them, majority of them are going to be high-grade dysplastic nodules, low-grade dysplastic nodule, regenerative nodules, and occasionally some unusual non-hepatocellular lesions. So what does that mean? So if we have a patient with LR3 observation, we know that the probability of HCC is about 30%, but what happens to the rest of the 70% of these observations? If we follow LR3s, a wide range, up to 60% will stay LR3. Some of them can actually decrease in category over time, and the minority, but important minority, up to 24%, will progress to more higher or malignant categories. This is an example. Again, anywhere between 25 to 60% of LR3 observations will stay like that. A wide variety will actually decrease, as you can see here, the case here, and about up to a quarter will progress to LR5 or LRM at 24 months. And here's an example of such a lesion, which went from 6 millimeter LR3 to a 2 centimeter T2 stage HCC in 2 years. What about LR4? So LR4, we know that a larger proportions are going to be HCC, about 65 to 70% based on different meta-analyses. And at 6 to 12 months, about 44% will remain LR4. A good chunk will progress to either LR5 or LRM, but an important minority will be actually down-categorized at 6 to 12 months. So this is an example. Again, a good proportion of LR4 observations will progress to higher categories, and this is an example of such a progression in 9 months. And if we look at cumulative incidence of HCC over time, this is based on one retrospective analysis, notice that LR3 observations followed up to 4 years steadily increased cumulative incidence of HCC, peaking at about 60% by year 4. And as not shocking, LR4 observations have a higher cumulative incidence. If we just focus on the LR3, again, another study showed that, again, similarly over time, close to 3 years, just under 40% of LR3 observations will become LR5. And interestingly, this is not different if we're looking at LR3s based on CT or based on MR. So why do you think, you know, you may be thinking like, why is it such a problem? But if you look at management schema for LR3, we have to repeat or alternate imaging every 3 to 6 months, recognizing that either that there's a substantial probability of progressing. If we look at what it means, like, look, all of these patients over time are getting very aggressive follow-up, which is, you know, a lot of energy, a lot of angst to the patient. And these are patients who are getting this aggressive follow-up, but really are okay and not developing anything bad. LR4 problem is slightly less severe because, again, a substantial large majority of LR4 observations are going to be HCCs, but still not all, right? And so potentially we're treating or following some of these LR4s when they don't need such an aggressive follow-up. So there are some imaging features that we know that are predictors of progression. They're listed here, particularly diffusion restriction, T2 hyperintensity, arterial phase hyperenhancement, and hepatobiliary phase hyperintensity. All of these have been proven to be predictors of progression in various studies. But even though these are great start, we still are not kind of hitting the target because we don't have an accurate way of predicting which one of the LR3s and LR4 observations require more aggressive follow-up and which ones can be safely watched in a less aggressive manner. So this is an important challenge that will still need to be addressed. And there are some studies that are being done to try to figure out how we can do better. So to summarize, use of LIRETS has a lot of advantages, including the fact that it's well scientifically validated and it works. We provide standardized assessment of lesion across the entire spectrum of what we see in cirrhosis. There's evidence that it may improve performance of users with less experience. And then it allows for clear and consistent communication of findings. And finally, it has been adopted by both ASLD and UNOS. So this is a big win for us. But there are some challenges, not quite disadvantages, but challenges for use, right? It is complex and takes time to learn. But again, this complexity may not be avoidable. But the heterogeneous outcome of LR4 and LR3 observations require more studying and require more data, and is an important challenge to address in the future. So LIRETS is not the beauty and the beast as in two things. It's both beauty and both the beast, because after all, nothing is perfect, but we are working at making things better and striving for perfection. With that, I'm going to thank you very much for your attention. And again, Richard, thank you so much for the opportunity to present today.